just kind of flip-flop those numbers. Beautiful. Have a seat, guys.
I want to welcome you and thank you for choosing to worship with us today. In spite of the rain, I was going to comment on the rain because I always comment on the weather. Like when it's bad weather, I'm always like, you know, really thankful when people come, because sometimes when it's bad weather, people don't come. Amen. So I'm glad when they do. And I was sitting here thinking about that before I came over here for church today. And I was thinking about it, and I was like, man, Lord, I really wish this was all snow. And some people are going to disagree with me, and that's fine. I'm not apologizing. I like it. Right? It is what it is. And then I come over here, and we're talking about the rain. I look outside, and there's snowballs coming down like this big, and I'm like, thank you, Jesus. That's just for me. I'm just kidding. But anyway, I'm glad y'all made it. Thank you for coming. If you're here for the first time or the first time in a long time, in front of you, you'll find a little yellow card that says welcome on it. And all we ask is that you fill that out with as much information as you're comfortable with. And that might just be your name, whatever it is. Just, you know, fill it out with as much. We just want to have a record of you being here with us today. The other thing is, you know, if you'd like to have a visit from me, or, you know, you got some things you need to pray about, or if you have, you know, whatever, you want to join the church or get baptized, anything, you can communicate it on that card. Or you can just talk to me. I'm kind of an approachable guy, I think, most of the time. So you can just talk to me about it. But just fill it out with as much information as you're comfortable with. And then there's two things you can do with it. If you're the type of person you don't want to talk to anybody, you just want to, you know, get it and go. Kind of thing. I respect that. I understand it. I know some folks are like that. You can put it in the plate, you know, whenever, either in just a few minutes when we have our welcome or at the end of service, and nobody will bother you. Or you can give it to Mom or Kathleen, who's ever back at the welcome station. As soon as you go out the door, it's on the right. And if you give it to them, they'll give you a gift just for choosing to worship with us today. We want you to have a gift. And then in addition to that, we have another gift for you. If you don't have a copy of God's Word, if you don't have a Bible, we want you to have one. So in front of you, you'll find a blue one, and it says Holy Bible on it. They're hard to miss in the pew. And if you don't have a Bible, take that one. We want you to have it. We really highly, you know, we highly value God's Word here. So much so that I don't take... We're not here for thus saith Josh Clifford. That's me, if you don't know what my name is. That's me. We're here for thus saith the Lord. So we want you to be able to follow along. And when I give the sermon here in a few minutes, I'll give page numbers, and you can follow along with the page numbers. So we want you to have that. I also want to thank everybody who came out, all the women who came out to the dinner. They said they had like 20. It was a big crowd. It was a good time. Ashley said that she was like one of the first ones to leave, so I know it had to be good because she never wants to come home once she gets out. She got a ton of kids and a husband that don't help, so anyway, it is what it is. I was kind of thankful because she rode with her sister, and I was like, well, they get to talk all the time, so you know, maybe there won't be the 3 or 4 hour conversation in the parking lot afterwards. Nope, they went to Walmart. So it is what it is. She texted me. She said, we're running into Walmart real quick. I said, I'll see you tomorrow. You know, it's like a black hole in that place. So you get lost. But anyway, they had a great time. This is, you know, we've been having our Wednesday night services. This week is the last week of that. And then we're moving to our small group. So after this week, we encourage you to come 7 o'clock this week as we finish out as far as we're going to get into the book of Acts. But then the following week, the first week in February, on Tuesday night, we're going to have a ladies group that meets at, 6:30 on Tuesday nights. And I know that there's a lot of people anticipating that. And so that the first one's going to be on February 6th. And they're going to have light refreshments and stuff, kind of like an introductory kind of day. So ladies, come to that. Be a part of it, 6:30. It's here at the church, and it's in the war room, and you probably don't know where the war room is if you're not familiar with the place. I'm going to tell you what we call the war room. It's not marked. We probably should, you know, but then if, like, we get infiltrated by the FBI or something, they'll be like, they're plotting, you know. Just kidding. But anyway, who knows nowadays? Just saying. If you go back to the drinking fountain, it's over your right shoulder, and since it's... I'm not going to say that because people get mad at me. Now I'll say it. And it's a women's Bible study, so if you just come in and listen for the voices, you'll find it. It is what it is, right? Same thing for Wednesday night. Wednesday night's the men's Bible study. and it's at 7 o'clock in the same place. So if you come, how we kind of handle the men's Bible study is we come in, we fellowship for the first hour, so 7 to 8, we're just fellowshipping and catching up on each other's lives, that kind of thing. And then from 8 to 9, we're studying the Bible. And then after that, we take prayer requests and we pray for one another. So that's happening on the 7th, which is next, not this Wednesday, but the week after. So come and be a part of that. Last week, I told you all about, I told you all about a baby sprinkle. And so if you know what I'm talking about, if you're like somebody that's here all the time, I feel like I have to explain this now because somebody told me, you know, that they thought when I talked about a baby sprinkle that it was talking about baptism. I'm not. Doesn't have anything to do with baptism at all. It has to do with a baby shower, right? You guys know what a baby shower is. But men don't go to baby showers. Amen, men? I know this is 2024, but men still don't go to baby showers and bridal showers. That's not what we do. Amen. I'll say it for you. So we call it a sprinkle so that we can go. That's scheduled for February 4th for Mary Cope, and, you know, they're having a baby. However, found out this week she went to the doctor. She's being induced on the 3rd. So we're not going to be able to have the sprinkle on the 4th. So we're rescheduling that, and we're going to reschedule it with her for a time after she comes home from the hospital and gets situated and all that. So that'll be rescheduled for a later date, but I wanted to bring you up to speed on it. On February 25th, we're having our Let Love Grow luncheon, which is an annual luncheon that we have after service here at the church. And it'll be February 25th over in the barn, and we're going to have, you know, we're going to have chicken because, you know, when two or three Baptists get together, a chicken must die. It's the official bird, right? The official bird of the Baptist Church, yes. You're welcome to, yeah, absolutely. Ty will smoke some pork, and we'll have a good time of fellowship. And if you'd like to, you can bring a cider or dessert to share, you know. But the important thing, and the reason why I'm telling you, is not so you can anticipate that we're going to have lunch that day, which I always look forward to. But a lot of times, if you feed them, they will come. So it will be a good day to invite your friends and family to come to church, you know. So on February 25th, invite your friends and family, and we'll have a meal after the service, okay? I think that's all the announcements that I have for now. What, did I miss? All right, thank you. At this time, I'm going to ask you to get up, shake somebody's hand, hug somebody's neck. If you're not into that kind of thing, and I know some people aren't, just stay seated. And if you see somebody seated, don't be hugging their neck and, you know, invading their space. Just tell them good morning and you're glad to see them. But especially introduce yourself if you don't know somebody, okay? We'll do that for 2 minutes. It'll be awkward for some, I get it, but 2 minutes we can welcome each other. All right?
Come on. Get to those seats. Get those glasses on. And let's sing these lyrics together as one body of Christ. Cause it's all because of Jesus, a giver of every breath I breathe, the author of all eternity, a giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory, maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your word, the king over all the universe, to you be the glory. And I am alive because I'm alive in you, and it's all because of Jesus I'm alive, and it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and raises dead men's life, and it's all my soul forget not all his benefits. How his light has shone through dark days and this, but he has been faithful. He's always faithful. And even as I'm walking through the wilderness, standing in the valley, oh, remember this, that he has been faithful. He's always faithful. And I know where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord. And I know where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord. And my confidence remains in the name above all names. And I know where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord. So I won't fear if I walk the windy ways. And for the name I call upon will be the same. Cause Jesus is faithful. He's always faithful. Yeah. I know.
Wonderful worshiping with you guys. Have a seat.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that curse. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all of.
If that don't get your blood moving, then we probably need to call a nurse. Amen. Man. That's the hope that we have. Resurrection in Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for that reminder. The reminder not only of what you did for us when you didn't have to, you don't need us. But Lord, you knew that we needed you, and we need you, continue to need you. So we thank you. We thank you for your work on the cross and for becoming the payment for our sin so that we can have that hope. That hope of the coming of the resurrection, in which we get to be with you forever. And thank you again for reminding us, Lord, that when you come back, it's not all, you know, it's not a meek and mild baby in a manger, but in robes of white, and your word says, on a horse, and those robes are dripped in blood, and you have a sword. We thank you for that. Because when we look out, we see so many injustices, we see so many evils in the world, and you know, things that not only we don't even have to look out, but we can look in and see in our own lives the problems that we have. And we recognize, Lord, that apart from you, apart from your forgiveness, apart from your indwelling spirit, apart from you forgiving us and saving us, there's nothing good in us. Because our hearts are sick and desperately wicked according to your word, and that's what we see also in our own lives. So Lord, we thank you today. We come with bowed heads and bowed hearts, humbly in thankfulness of what you've done and how much you love us. Lord, it truly is beyond amazing that you chose to love me. You chose to love us and to pay for our sin, those wicked sins that we have in our lives that because we're sinners. And you chose to pay for those, to make a way so that we could be with you forever. Thank you for that, Lord. And as we get into your word, I pray, Lord, that we hold this word highly above anything else in our lives. That, Lord, when we get into your word, we recognize that we're not reading Harry Potter. We're not reading Lord of the Rings. Lord, this is the word of God. Remind us of that. And, Lord, as we elevate you in our lives and lift you up and make you the most important thing in our lives, there are going to be some things in our lives that are going to be shown to us by your Spirit that we have to get rid of. And that we have to repent of. And Lord, for those things, I pray that you convict us and give us a heart of repentance, and that we would turn away from those things and be transformed and be molded and shaped into your image and not the image of the world. Use this time that we have together, Lord, to do that in our lives. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 10 is where we're at today. Page 904 is where we're going to be. I actually didn't write that down on my paper, so I'm going to write it down now for future generations. So they'll be like, page 904 in what Bible? So hopefully they find one of the Bibles with it. I was trying to look for something last night. And if any of you are like me, I have things in my life and in my house that I don't need. And when I don't need them, they're right in my face. And then the time comes that I've been preparing for in which I do need them. And I go and try to find them, and they're nowhere to be found. It was that case last night, and I was going through trying to find something.
And I came across notebook after notebook after notebook, and I was like, man, I've been preaching a long time. You know what I mean? So I was like, well, maybe when I die, this will be good for the kids or something. So we'll hang on to them. But anyway, so if you're here for the first time or the first time in a long time, I'm going to remind you what we're doing. And that is that we're going through God's Word, through the Gospels specifically, and we're tracking through the life of Jesus, right? We're going through the life of Christ. And this is a brilliant invention, by the way. Oh, it's not this one. Never mind. I get sidetracked. I got a mind like a squirrel. But you know how pockets sometimes have the fold-over thing that goes over the top, you know, to keep everything in? I have shirts, and this isn't one, but I thought it was when I felt that have the enclosed section, and right next to it, it's got a little spot for your pen. And I was like, that's genius. Why am I just finding out about this at 44 years old? You know, maybe it took us that long to put pockets in women's pants, so who knows? You know, as if women don't need pockets in their pants. My daughter reminds me of that all the time. She enjoys a good pair of pants that has pockets. But anyway, just to remind you kind of what we're doing is we're going through the life of Jesus. And we're looking at it kind of in a chronological way. So, you know, kind of a chronological means like, you know, in order of time. And so we're trying to do that and glean from it all that we can, from his teaching, from his actions, from, you know, everything that Jesus does and says, we're trying to learn from it. And so we're doing that, and we've been doing it for quite some time, over a year we've been doing it. And so we're going to continue with that. And there's a lot that's happened, which I understand. You can go back and read all of it whenever you have time. But in this particular moment, one of the things that Jesus was doing was going through and he was healing folks. And the way that he healed folks, it was like at the beginning, it was kind of like he goes and heals a few people and then people, like crowds form, they kind of push him out, you know. And then it went to like, you know, you go to a well where there's all kinds of people that want to be healed. He heals one. So it's kind of like sporadic healing. And then they came against him, and they basically said that, you know, he was casting out demons and stuff by the power of Satan, by Beelzebub, and all this kind of stuff. This plays in, and this is important for the end of today's sermon. He says that they're doing it. They accuse him of doing it by the power of Satan, and he schools them on who he is, right? He tells them about who he is, and he provides witness as to who he is. And, you know, all the works that he does proves who he is. And so then he ratchets it up. So now it's not just that he's going in and healing, you know, one person here, one person there. He starts to go into towns and heal everybody. Right? And so that draws some attention. And the need is great because I'm going to tell you something. When you have something good, you tell your buddies about it. Right? And so if you have some kind of an ailment and it's something that maybe you've dealt with your whole life, like, you know, you're blind and you've been blind your whole life and somebody heals you, then you're going to tell people about it, right? And then guess what they're going to want? They're going to want healing in their own lives, right? So then they come. Isn't that crazy how that works, right? And then the crowds grow. So he sees the crowd, and more importantly than their physical ailments are their spiritual ailments. And in the midst of all this, people are coming along. The religious authorities are coming against him, asking him all these questions, accusing him of all kinds of things. You know, all this stuff's going on. And he looks out, and he's like, you know, the harvest is ready, but there aren't enough workers. So he tells the disciples, pray for workers. Right? And then he sends them out as workers. Amen? And I pointed that out, that the same people that he tells to pray for workers are the people that he sends to do the work. And so I think that's important for us because I'm going to tell you something. Following Christ is not a spectator sport. It's not something that you watch on TV. It's not something that you come here to look at others doing. It's not that kind of a thing. It's the kind of thing where you get in because you're on somebody's team, whether you like it or not. You're either on the side of Christ or you're on the side of the enemy. There is no middle neutral ground. Amen? Like I've heard said before and I've said before, if you're riding the fence, I just want you to know that the devil owns the fence. Amen? So he tells them in this passage, he gives them some instructions. And that's what we're looking at, is these instructions as he's about to send out his disciples. Well, as soon as I get, I tell myself all the time, I'm going to quit forgetting my glasses. And then every week, not just every week, it's every Sunday, Wednesday, anytime I need to read, I forget my glasses. I apologize. We're going to begin in verse 10 of Matthew chapter 10. Is that right? I may have written that down wrong. No, it's not verse 10. It's verse 16. I did write that down wrong. I wrote it right in one section and then wrong in another section. Bear with me. Somebody will pick this up in years to come, and they'll see this, and then they'd be like, well, where did he get that from that? Yeah, he just didn't write it right. All right, verse 16, it says, behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? Now, the first thing that I want to point out is in the very first verse 16, which I'll read again. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. The Lord said to them that he's sending the disciples out as sheep among wolves. That wolves word tells us something very specific. And that is that he's saying, I'm sending you out in the midst of false prophets, false teachers. As a matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 15, he specifically says that false teachers will look like sheep, but they're actually ravenous wolves. And so that's a consistent interpretation of when he says wolves. False teachers are going to be out there. Amen? If you read what I just read, it's not very comforting. You know what I mean? It's not like he said, and I think sometimes as Christians, we want to believe that this is what he said. I'm sending you out to padded pews and air conditioning. I'm sending you out to warm coffee and fresh baked goods. I'm sending you out to sit in pews and to listen to somebody talk about me, but to not do ever anything about it except stay comfortable. That's what I want for you, is to be comfortable. I want you to come and I want you to have emotional experiences together. That's what I'm sending you out to, emotional experiences. And then when you have those emotional experiences, you know, you can put money in the plate and then I'll give you more money, because I really want you to be comfortable and rich and happy and healthy and all of those things. Isn't that what Jesus said? I want you to have really nice clothes. When I say pew, you may not even know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about wooden seats. Oh, wooden seats, that's suffering. No, they're padded. Is that what Jesus said? I'm sending you out to comfort? He didn't even say, I'm sending you out as sheep amongst other sheep. Did he? He said, I'm sending you out like sheep amongst wolves. Sheep amongst wolves. That's what he's sending us out to. That's what he's sending them out to. And I want to tell you that when I read through all of this, right? Now, the disciples during this stage in Jesus' life, they get to witness Jesus endure these types of things. But they themselves don't endure these types of things during the life of Christ. But as soon as he's gone, as soon as he raises from the dead and ascends to heaven, it all falls on them, just like he said it would. If you've been going through the book of Acts with us on Wednesday nights, you know exactly what I'm talking about. They were literally going house to house looking for Christians. So much so that they had to do exactly what Jesus said, run from one city and go to another city and tell people about Jesus there. They were brought in front of the councils. They were brought into the synagogues. They were whipped. They were imprisoned. And literally, they gave their lives for the sake of Christ. And you want to tell me that the prosperity gospel explains accurately what Jesus said would happen and what the apostles experienced? And I got news for you. I've read the end of the book. Even though there was that near time fulfillment within the lives of the apostles, the full manifestation of it comes before Jesus splits the skies. You know what I'm saying? When he comes back in his robes of white and all that kind of stuff. In the lead up to that, then a lot of us are going to be experiencing that. And I want to tell you something that it scares me as the body of Christ. It scares me that we are so addicted to comfort that the slightest bit of persecution, and I'm going to tell you something, them telling you you got lead in your Stanley cups, not persecution.
Amen.
I'll do it myself. That's not persecution. You know, I'm just saying that our idea of what it means to be a Christian is so much different than what Jesus explained it would be. Right? If they said that the master of the house was Beelzebub, was Satan, right? And they treated him like that, how do you expect him to treat you? You're better than Jesus? I'll get to that in just a little bit. But he's calling them out a sheep amongst wolves. And what does he say? He says, I want you to be wise like a serpent. And that wise word, it kind of trips people up sometimes. I think that a better translation of the word might be shrewd. Be shrewd like a serpent. Why? Because the enemy wants to put you in danger. Amen? He's going to use a bunch of different ways to put you in danger. The scriptures even tell us about some of the ways. And as a matter of fact, it says in the book of James that he'll entice you, that he'll lure you in. It actually uses like fishing terms, like lure you in with your own desires, which are good desires that God gave you. But he'll put things in front of you to fulfill those desires that are not of God. And then you'll give in to that. And when you do, it gives birth to sin. And when you have sin, that leads to death. Isn't that what it tells us? So he uses bait, he uses lures to entrap you, to entice you in, to be in opposition to God, to be impotent, to not be effective in your walk, to be jaded and stuck and not a witness for Christ. Because I'm going to tell you something, if you belong to Jesus, there ain't a thing the devil can do about that. I want to say it again. Because I want you to really understand it. If you belong to Jesus, there's not a thing the devil can do about that. No one, no man's going to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Isn't that what Jesus said? It's exactly what he said. Satan can't do it. So a nice second would just get you to not do what Jesus says. How can we do that? Well, he can entice you, he can entrap you, and all that kind of stuff. So you got to think, you know, like he does, to avoid the entrapments, to avoid the snares, right? You got to kind of try to anticipate the attacks from the enemy. If you got weaknesses in your life, things that are a specific temptation to you, then your prayer should be, Lord, lead us not into temptation. You should stay away from that, amen? But if you happen to come into it, come into it with the knowledge that Jesus gives you a way out of the temptation. Amen? Right. So he says to be shrewd like a serpent. And then he says to be innocent like a dove. That word innocent, I wrote it out phonetically so I could try to pronounce the Greek word correctly. Try again. I'm terrible at these things, by the way. Ready? Here we go. Akarioi. Akarioi. It's the word that literally means unmixed and pure. That's what it means. Unmixed and pure, literally. It's used two other times in the New Testament. And those two times are Romans chapter 16 and verse 9 and Philippians chapter 2 and verse 15. It literally means unmixed or pure. He says, I'm sending you out into the presence as sheep in the amongst wolves, amongst false prophets, false teachers, and I want you to be shrewd like a serpent. They're going to try to entrap you. They're going to try to get you to buy into what they're selling. But you need to be innocent, unmixed with that they're selling, pure from that what they're selling, that false doctrine. That cannot be in what you are and what you teach. Amen? I'm sending you out as sheep amongst wolves. So you got to be shrewd like an enemy, like the enemy, like a serpent, innocent, free from false doctrine. Don't allow false doctrine to mix in with your pure motivations either. Did you know that? That sometimes if Satan can't corrupt your doctrine, he'll try to corrupt your motivation. Some people use good doctrine with corrupt motivation and end up just as on a wrong path, just like the ones teaching false doctrine. Right? Beware. Right? Beware. Our doctrine must be true. It must be pure. It must not be mixed with the lies of the enemy. Because I'm going to tell you something. If you have a whole big bucket of nothing but pure and you put one impurity in it, one drop of impurity, the whole thing becomes impure. That's the reason why there are songs from certain groups that we just won't sing. And some people are like, but I heard it on K-Love. I don't care where you heard it. Well, they play it on the radio. It's got to be good. Do you know K-Love's doctrine? I didn't think so. Maybe you should find out. Why does K-Love exist? Is it truly just to help Christians? I don't know. There's a lot of people making money. I'm not accusing them because I don't know. But what I'm saying is that a lot of people treat K-Love and what they hear on Christian radio and from Christian artists like it's church. Like it's the scriptures. You got to make sure it's like the scriptures. Amen? Because just a drop of impurity makes the whole thing impure. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Right? Isn't that the truth? Yeah. So we have to guard against that in our motivations, in our doctrine, in who we are. The second thing it says, I'll probably get in trouble for this one. It's cool. It says, beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you'll be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. And listen, it says that you'll be turned over to worldly authorities. He didn't say, I'll turn you over to comfort, or you'll be turned over to comfort. Doesn't say you'll be turned over to your favorite, your meal, you know, to courts. If I were writing a new translation, you know, if I were interpreting this for the latest generations, then I would probably rephrase it and I'd say, beware of snitches. The younger folks are like, yeah, I got you. Huh. Why? Because people are going to take you. Bottom line is, there's going to come a time, and there was a time, and we've seen it in the past, in which the disciples were trying to tell people about Jesus, and literally men would hear what they say and then take them and report them to the authorities, who would come and arrest them and then drag them in before the authorities, right? That would actually happen, and it's going to happen again. Have you all read the end of the book? It's coming again. And it makes me so nervous for the church. And I'm going to tell you what it makes me nervous for, because some of us are like, yeah, but when those persecutions come, I'll be just fine. I won't recant my faith. I'll be just fine. Yeah, you'd be real surprised what you'll give up for a loaf of bread when you're hungry. You're like, no, I'd starve to death, right? I'd starve to death into the kingdom. That's where I'd go. Yeah, but what if they did it to your kids? I mean, honestly, that's what we have to be preparing for. We don't have to prepare for them. Oh, well, the government, you know, they shut us down. The government shut us down. You know, they turned the lights off at the church. They stopped giving us electricity. They started making the church pay taxes. God forbid. You know, and people, sometimes I think that people in the church think that we're called to be a 501c3. We're not. We're called to be the church. If they want to give us a tax break for being the church, that's fine. But I'm not going to change anything that we're doing or our doctrine. But I'm telling you, it's coming down the pike. It'll come down the pike. And I'm going to tell you what they're going to use. They're going to use our position on godly marriage to do it. They're going to say, that's hate speech. We can't support hate speech. And if they're using hate speech, then they got to pay taxes at the very least. That's how it's going to start. I'm not a prophet. I'm just telling you, look at the world. That's what's coming. And for a little while, it'll be tolerated under that. You know, they got that. But then it's going to escalate, because I'm going to tell you something. The bottom line is, eventually, just like it has happened in the past, they're going to drag you in front of the authorities for your faith. And some of us will just see it happening to others and buckle. You're like, what do you mean? I mean, Jesus was serious when he said that those who persevere to the end will be saved. That implies that there are some who will not persevere. What does that mean, Josh? Does it mean they'll lose their salvation? No, it means they're pretenders. They never had it. Right? Judas literally walked with Jesus. You know what I mean? He's in the group of the 12 that Jesus is talking to right now. Right? Probably in the back eating it all up. Yeah, amen. Amen. Make sure you put your money in the bucket. Amen. Because he was the one that held the money, right? And the Bible tells us that while he was holding the money, that he stole from the money purse, didn't he? That implies he was never regenerated. He never sold out to this thing, never surrendered his life to Christ. And there are some people within the body of Christ that when this stuff begins, you're going to fall away because you never had it. You're like, man, I didn't know I was coming to this kind of church today. Well, I'm going to tell you, there's plenty that won't tell you this. There's plenty that won't talk about it. There are plenty that pretend that this is just for that time and that this is a different time. And so now we're supposed to be comfort and you know, comfortable and sitting in our padded pews and just come and check your box every week and then go home and act like Jesus doesn't exist the rest of the week. That's not Christianity. That's not following Christ. He said that I'm sending you out like sheep amongst wolves. You're supposed to go out there and just lay down and die? No, you're supposed to be shrewd like a serpent and innocent as a dove, knowing that there are people that are going to carry out these terrible things by reporting us to authorities and taking us before courts. Flogging in the synagogues is what it said. The disciples were beat for their faith. We just got through in the book of Acts where James was put to the sword. And Herod Agrippa saw that the people liked it, so he arrested Peter too. I was going to do the same thing to him. But an angel intervened. Listen. Jesus was warning them. He was telling them and instructing them that when they go out to carry out their important mission of carrying out the gospel and spreading the gospel, that all kinds of persecutions are guaranteed. It's guaranteed. It's coming. They'll drag you into court. They'll beat you in the synagogue. They'll drag you in front of governors and authorities and governments. And it's not because you're just not a nice person. It's not because they just, you're not popular. It's not because of any of that. It's because of Jesus. He says, for my name's sake. Isn't that what he said? That's why. Now, your job is just to make sure that it ain't because of you, because you might get dragged into court because you're a jerk. Amen? Wait, that's not persecution. That's stupidity. Right? Live out what's in you, this gospel that you say that you have, spreading it, and that's an important mission that he didn't just tell the disciples, amen? He also explained it to everybody when he ascended in, right before he ascended into heaven. He said, you, go make disciples. And as long as you're going and making disciples, then his gospel spreads in the world. And when it spreads in a world that hates him, persecutions will come, not because they hate you, which they do, by the way, but because they hate him. It amazes me so much that we so desperately want to be a part of what hates us. You know what I'm saying? Like we feel left out in this like we're, you know, I can't go to this party, I can't watch this thing, you know, that kind of thing. And I'm like, man, you know, that's true. There's lots of things that I tend to stay away from. But I never think of it like that in terms of I can't watch this thing. I can watch that thing. It's very easy. Right? For most things now, it's very easy. It's in the palm of your hand if you just pay a subscription. That's how easy it is. And Satan's going to make it easier as time goes on. Best he can to be a part of the world. And when you're not a part of that, then you feel like you're being left out. Listen, there's no such thing as being left out in the kingdom of God. If you have given your life to Christ, then you're not left out. You do belong to the kingdom. Don't desire the world. They hate you. It hates you because it hates Jesus. Amen? You're like, man, this is intense today. Take a breath. It's going to be okay. We're going to keep reading. There's comfort coming. Here's comfort enough. Or it could be for most of us. See, when Satan uses those things and the snitches go snitching and the governments be governing and all that kind of stuff, when that happens, when if we just look at it from our perspective, we're missing the point. When that happens, it's for a purpose. Did you see what he said? Let's read it again. Verse 19, when they deliver you over, wrong before that, and you'll be dragged before governors and kings for my sake. Why? To bear witness before them and the Gentiles. So in other words, there's a purpose behind that. Anybody that you find yourself in front of didn't happen by accident. Right? Do we believe that God's sovereign or we do not? Every person that we come in contact with, every person that we are in front of, every person that is in front of us, it's not an accident. It's a God divinely appointed moment that you get to be a witness for him. Whether that's before the courts, whether that's in the synagogue, whether that's before kings, no matter where it's at, if you're in front of someone, that someone needs Jesus. Right? So, the thing that Satan may intend for good, dragging you in front of the courts and all that kind of stuff, you know, all that kind of thing, the thing that Satan may intend for evil, for his purposes, God can use for good. Amen? Listen, his word is real. All things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. All things, every little thing, even being dragged before the courts, even being imprisoned, even losing your life for the kingdom means you gain eternity. Amen? What do I always say? All they can do is change your address. Amen? What I got waiting for me is way better than what I got here. Even though I love what I got here. Amen? Just imagine. I think about that, and I'm like, man, Paul was so obedient to God's word. He went and did the thing he was told to do, that God told him to do, to go and reach the Gentiles. He did that, amen? He was an obedient servant of Christ to the point of death. And when I think about that, Paul even talked about it himself. He's like, I can, consider it all joy, brother. Consider it joy. Yeah, consider it joy to go before Caesar and to be able to witness to Caesar. If he went before Caesar, I guarantee, because of Paul's history, Caesar heard about Christ and was given the gospel. Amen? Man, I pray that each one of us would be worthy to go before kings and give them the gospel. So then the Caesar, rejects Christ and takes Paul's head. You can have his head. Because Jesus has got Paul for eternity. Streets of gold, walls of jasper, the whole deal, the crystal sea, all of it, and more. But number three, if that happens, then I'm not very good with speech. Don't worry about it, Jesus says. I don't know what to say. Don't worry about that. I hear so many times that people are frozen in their witness. They won't tell other people about Jesus because they're afraid they don't know what to say. Let's see what God's word says. Again, when they deliver you, verse 19, when they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. Right when you need it, you get the very thing that you need to have, because that's how God works, amen? Right when you need it. Don't be afraid. Listen, don't be afraid to tell people about Jesus. Don't be anxious because you don't know the words to say. Just step out on faith and do what God tells you to do. He'll take care of everything else, amen? You're like, well, maybe I'm not as good as, putting it, talking about it like Josh is. Well, that's fine. The people you may talk to may not need somebody that talks to like I do. They might need to hear from somebody that talks like you do. That's the truth of it, amen? That's why there's so many of us. That's why we're all members of one body. Each of us has a unique voice given by God with new, unique experiences that he's walked us through. And so when he tells us to go and to make disciples, he's not just talking about the fat guy that stands in front with the Bible in front of him and at the podium. He's not just talking about me. Praise God, because that would be too much for me to bear. He's talking about you. Amen? Don't be afraid. Don't be anxious. I don't know what to say. No, he'll give it to you at exactly the right time. And I'm going to tell you now, I've been following Christ for a while. And there have been times in my life where I just don't know what to say. I know some of y'all are like, yeah, right. No, seriously. There's been plenty of times where I shrink back, where I feel like, I'm not going to have the words. I mean, if you think that I have all the words for all the occasions, then you've never been with me to visit with family that just lost their loved one. Because I'm going to tell you that when I go into those situations, I mean, what do you say? You know what I mean? What if the someone that they lost, from the fruits of their life that there was no indication that they'd ever given their life to Christ? What do you say? Sometimes it's enough to just cry with people. There's been plenty of times that I've done that. But I always go, and the reason that I go is because I know that in the situation that God will give exactly what's needed at the exact time it's needed. Don't worry about that. Can't worry about that. Because we have a job to do. Amen? It's like going to war. You know, when you go to war, you're like, well, do I have enough bullets? Listen, the Holy Spirit don't run out. You know what I mean? He's got it all. It all belongs to him. The other thing is, we put so much pressure on our words that we just completely discount God's Spirit. You know what I mean? And we think if we don't say it exactly right, then they're not going to accept it. Well, if they did accept it because of the way that you put it, did they really accept it? If there's not a move of the Holy Spirit, they won't. There's nothing you can say and no way you can say it. It has to be the work of the Holy Spirit. It can't be your work. That's why when Paul goes in, you know, he goes into, I forget where, maybe Corinth. He's like, I didn't come with sophistry. I didn't come with all these beautiful words and stuff. I came exhibiting the power of the Holy Spirit. Because I'm telling you, if the Spirit's not in it, it doesn't matter how good you can talk. I'm going to tell you, there's plenty of guys out there that talk in way better terms, are so much more eloquent than I am and all that other kind of stuff, and they're snakes. And the Spirit's not in them. Right? I know, because millions of people tune in to hear what they have to say. And I'm going to tell you that these false doctrines that are out today, these false things that are going around, they get more and more wicked as time goes on. And it's subtle to those who don't understand the Scriptures. But to those of us who do, it's like billboards. The latest thing, you know, that's coming down the pike, it's not new, it's been going on for some time, but the latest iteration of that, there's a lady, and primarily she's out west, but she's going all over the world, and I don't remember her name, and if I did, I probably wouldn't even say it because I don't want you to look her up, because there's no other word to call it except satanic. There's no other word to call it, and this is what she does. She has these deliverance services. Deliverance services. As soon as somebody starts talking about deliverance, you need to ask the question, what do you mean by that? Because a lot of times it's a thinly veiled attempt at prosperity gospel, at mysticism, at paganism. There's so much stuff that they wrap up into that word deliverance that when you accept it, you accept all that comes with it. So always ask the question, what do you mean by that? In her case, what she means is that she's some spiritual guru that stands on the stage and talks a bunch of fancy word salad that means absolutely nothing, by the way. If you listen to it and understand what they're saying, they're not saying anything except trying to get you to play on your emotions, to get you to come forward, and then you come forward because you got to have this deliverance, and they're the only ones that can give it to you. They're the only ones. And they get these people that come and they're hurt and they're broken and they're having all kinds of difficulty in their lives, just like the rest of us, by the way. And they're searching. And they come and say, well, the problem is you don't have enough faith. So why don't you come down and show how much faith you have, and then I'll speak deliverance over you and touch you, and then you're going to be delivered. Because God told me I could. And they say these things. Like I heard somebody saying this week, and it may have been her, that we can't just trust the word of God. We have to go beyond it. We have to go to what he's telling us in our lives now and the prophecies that he gives us now. As long as they're in line with the word of God, they're okay. And I got to tell you that there's something dangerous in even that. Here's why it's dangerous. Because you can be convinced of just about anything is permissible when people mistreat, misinterpret the word of God. They can manipulate it in ways that you don't even think about because that's not how we think. We're not trying to manipulate the word of God. We're trying to live by it. But they will manipulate the word of God. So they try to put in these little things. You know, so you come and you get deliverance. And they have people that come up. This one guy, he had to come up three times in three different cities. And these people coming back over and over again to get this deliverance that this person has that apparently looks a whole lot like somebody shaking and convulsing on the floor and screaming. And they said that if you don't believe like they do, it's because you have a demon. No, I don't believe how they do because I have the Spirit of God. Which, of course, they're going to call a demon. That's what they did to Jesus. And so they come up and they lay hands on him and, you know, they shake and convulse on the floor. And then they come back. So they had to come up with a way. Well, how do we keep it going when we come under this criticism that these people have to return over and over again to get this deliverance? Why isn't one time good enough? Well, first of all, it's not biblical. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm going to tell you something. If God delivers you, you're delivered. Amen? That blind guy that Jesus healed didn't come back a week later and say, hey, I need cataract surgery. Did he? It wasn't like once the lame man got healed that somebody had to push him in a wheelchair to go see Jesus a second time to get more delivered. It was done, amen? So they had to come up with something. So basically what she said is, well, you know, when you have it, when you're here and you get this deliverance, you have enough faith. But when you leave here, you don't have enough faith. So you got to come back and get delivered again. What they're saying is, here's the drug. I'm the dealer. You can't get it anywhere else, so come back and buy more. That's what it is. It is literally a scheme, worse than a Ponzi scheme. That's what it is. That's the kind of false doctrine that we see today. And I'm going to tell you that it's not new. It's been around a long time, amen? It's been around since the real thing showed up. Amen. So, when we come into folks and God puts people in front of us, I don't care who they are, they need the truth. They need the pure and innocent, unmixed, pure doctrine of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. That is what leads to salvation. Not these false doctrines. All they are is emotional Ponzi schemes and worse. To pry on people. It's satanic. You're like, well, Josh, that's awful harsh just because they don't believe like you do. No, they don't believe like Jesus does. I'm not judging them. I'm telling you what God already has judged. That's the truth of it. Well, their faith, they're really sincere about it. I don't care. I don't care. I mean, there were some Muslims that really cared about their faith, really sincere about it, to the point of death. And I can unequivocally tell you that Jesus said there is one way to him, and that's Jesus. There's only one way to the Father, that's Jesus. There is the truth and the life, and that's Jesus. It's not Muhammad. It's not anybody, any other name. There is no other name under heaven in which you can be saved but Jesus. That's it. I don't care how sincere you are. You can be sincerely wrong. And I know plenty of people that are. I have been in my life sincerely wrong before. Any of you guys ever had that? I sure have. You get married to it, right? Because you're so sincere. But then God opens your eyes and shows you the truth. And when that truth is revealed, then the truth you know will set you free. Isn't that what he says? There's freedom in that. Whoever gets in front of you, give them the gospel. Give them your testimony. Tell them what Jesus has done for you. Tell them what his word says. And number four, don't stop. Don't stop. Even I don't care how bad it gets, don't stop. Look at what he says. He says that this is how bad it can get. Verse 21, brother will deliver brother over to death. That's pretty bad, amen? Brother will deliver brother over to death. It says that a father will turn on his child. That's terrible. It says the children will out their parents. That's bad. Amen? And it says you'll be hated by them. You'll be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Don't ever stop. Why? Because our job's not done. The job's not finished until you're standing on streets of gold. The job's not finished until you're face to face with the one who saved you. Amen? The job's never done as long as you have breath in your body, because people need Jesus. There will be a time to rest, and that time to rest will come. Right now, your rest is in Christ. Amen? Right now, the work is to be done. And don't ever stop, no matter how bad it gets. Even if brothers turning family are turning each other in. But understand that they're not doing it just because it's, don't take it personal.
That's the way I look at it. Don't take it personal. It'll sure feel personal, amen?
Don't take it personal. It's not because they hate you. They hate Jesus. They hate you. But they hate you because of Jesus. Amen? The world will always hate you because it'll always hate Jesus. So don't stop. Don't stop living out what he's taught. Don't stop worshiping him. Don't stop presenting the gospel to whoever in front of you. Deliverance is coming. Real deliverance. Amen? Real, lasting deliverance, because the one who endures to the end will be saved. And the fifth thing, and the last thing, verse 24, a disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of the household? If they had the audacity to stand in front of Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, and call him Beelzebub, what do you think they'll do to you? Amen? The point here is very simple. Be like your master. What Jesus is telling them is, listen, I'm not calling you to do anything that I haven't done or won't do. It's coming, amen? Jesus is going to go through more. There's comfort in that. But the thing that we can't expect, we can't be expected to be treated better than Jesus. The only thing that we can expect is to try to be like Jesus. Amen? What exactly do you think he means when he says, take up your cross and follow me? Take up your cross. Oh, by cross, he's talking about, you know, my Gucci purse and my Stanley cup and, you know, my little pet, you know, my little pet in a bag, you know, my coat, my fur coat, you know. That's what he's talking about, take up your cross. I'm picking on Stanley cups today. I don't mean to. I just don't understand why you need to keep ice cold for 5 days. If you've got a drink the last 5 days, get a smaller cup.
Amen.
Thank you. You know what I'm saying? They're probably really good. I don't know. That's just the topic of the day. I apologize. Because really, it ain't about that. Amen. When he says take up your cross, he's not saying, you know, oh, it's a cross to bear because, you know, church starts at 10:30, so I got to wake up at like 10:15. Act like some of y'all don't wake up at 10:15 and get there as fast as you can. Hey, I've been late. I know how it feels. And some of y'all, man, that's what you got, you know. It's, this is what I can do. Then do it. Praise God that you do. Amen? Some of y'all, man, I'm so impressed when I see, like, single moms coming in with, like, three kids in their arms, you know, and the kids are, like, half-dressed and, you know, all that kind of thing. I'm like, man, good job, Mom. You made it. Praise God. Amen? But what I'm saying is, when he says take up your cross, it's not a persecution to you that church starts before noon. Right? I ain't talking about that. What's he talking about? Take up your cross might look like, you know, there's this push for you to jump on all the things that society's jumping on. But listen, when I say society, you know what I'm talking about. It's the world. The culture, that's the world. What does it mean when I talk about the world? I'm talking about the man-centered, Satan-driven system in which we live, right? That's what I'm talking about. It's all about you. It's all about man. But it's driven by Satan. right? That's what I'm talking about. And in that society in which we live, we're drifting further and further away from Christ. It's inevitable. It's the way, societies are. That happens throughout history. If you look at everything, it's all cyclical, you know. And the next thing on the docket, by the way, spoiler alert, is a dictatorship. And in every society throughout history, you can go look. Like when they start with their art and stuff and they begin to develop their culture and all that, you'll see their art and they have like these statues of men. They're like chiseled and buffed and wearing fur and these big swords and all that kind of stuff. By the end of the culture, you can't tell the men from the women in the statues. The man gets feminized. After that happens, right, then society starts to give more to those who do nothing. That's part of it. It happens at the same time. And so then the people who are given without giving demand more and more. And then the society gives into them as the society begins to move away from morality, because morality in almost every religion on the face of the earth says, you work, you eat. It's in our Bible, right? But they use whatever means, you know, they start taking the government and taxpayer money and all that kind of stuff, putting it in places that it doesn't belong, excessive spending, all that stuff happens, a lack of morality, and then somebody shows up on the scene promising to fix it all. And when they promise to fix it all, everybody listens and they start to, you know, give in to this guy that's going to fix it all. And for whatever reason, there's usually a bad thing that happens in the society, like a big thing. Like for Germany, it was World War I, big bad problem that they had after that, because now they had to pay reparations to all these countries. You know, and they tried to do it for a little while, but it made the German people feel like garbage because, you know, they lost this war that they were a part of and all this, and they're losing money. Inflation's outrageous. I'm telling you, the signs are there. Inflation gets outrageous. People can't eat. When you can't eat, then somebody comes along saying, I'll feed you. And then the people will say, yes, then I love you. Give us the bread. Give us the bread. We have a Savior. And then they elect that person. That person becomes a dictator. Eventually, though, dictators fall. And then guess what happens? Back to the creation of the society. Reestablishment of morals, you know, all that kind of stuff. It's all cyclical. It happened throughout history. Go look. That's the next things on the sign. You don't think that in the United States, as we drift farther and farther away from Christ, that there's not going to be some persecution? Gird your loins. Amen? We're not called to comfort. We're called to give people the truth. Even if it costs us our lives, to spread the gospel and the hope of Jesus Christ. That is our responsibility. And he's not asking you to do anything that he didn't do himself. Even unto death. Right? You're like, well, this wasn't one of those motivational, uplifting kind of sermons. It was if you listen closely. It says that the one who endures till the end will be saved. Joe Osteen said you can live your best life now. That's one of the reasons why I don't know if the dude's saved. Because if you're a Christian, you know this isn't the best part of life. If you're a Christian, this is the closest you're ever going to get to tasting hell. Heaven's coming. Amen? The bad news is, if you're not a Christian, if you haven't given your life to Christ, then this is the closest you'll ever taste to heaven. The good news is, Jesus died as a payment for your sin so that you could have heaven, so that you could have him. And he is hope. He is truth. He is love. And that's available to you. Circumstances may seem dire, but Jesus is hope. Amen? Doesn't matter what circumstances look like when you got Jesus. You can count it all joy, brethren, when you come into various trials. Because those trials creates something in you, like patience and endurance. Amen? So the question is today, who are you going to be? You're going to be the one that Jesus sent out? You're going to be the one trying to pretend like he never said that? I just showed you that he did, so you got to deal with it. Now you do that. But let the Holy Spirit speak into your life. Let the Holy Spirit guide you. When I say speak into your life, I'm not talking about what knucklehead with the deliverance thing is talking about. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about let the Holy Spirit guide you, teach you through God's word who you are to be. Let God shape you and mold you by the transforming, by the renewing of your mind, transforming you into the image of Christ. Because that's what we can ask. That's what we can hope for, is to be like our master. They hated him. They put him to death. You're like, well, why would I ever accept that if that's what you're promising? You're promising that I'm going to be persecuted, because I'm going to tell you that this life is temporary, but heaven is eternal. That's why. Those sins that you've committed, the things that he paid for on the cross, he'll forgive you of. That's why he died on the cross, to pay for them. It's been satisfied. He did that for you so that you could have hope. Without him, there's no hope. Without him, there's all this wickedness and then hell. But with him, there is hope. So you choose. You want to keep on desiring the world? You want to keep on going with the Joneses and all that? You know, you want to keep on feeling like you're missing something there? Or do you want to have life and have life more abundantly? Because that's found in Christ. So that's your offer today. I'm not going to beat a dead horse. I'm not going to, you know, keep on rambling. But that's your offer. To repent of your sin. Be forgiven of it. And have life eternal. And some of you might be thinking, well, you don't know what I have done. Jesus does. And he said, whosoever, which is you, shall call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. So why don't you do that today? Don't wait another minute. Yeah, well, I want to get my life cleaned up. It drives me nuts when people say that, by the way. It's like saying that you need to wipe off before you get in the shower. Why not just get in the shower? You know, jump in 2 feet, get clean. He'll do it. I'm going to offer you that chance right now. We're going to pray. As we do, you spend some time with God. If you're one of those people and you're like, God, I'm following you, but I don't know. You know, Josh talking about persecution and stuff like that. Listen, I don't want you to think, and I don't want anybody here to be doubting their salvation if they're truly saved. I don't want any of that to happen, because we know that God gives us what we need in the moment for the moment, doesn't he? So if you have him, don't fear. There's nothing to fear. Read the next part. I might end with that and give you a preview of next week, but this is what it says. And then we'll pray. So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both the soul and the body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Listen to this. This is how cheap sparrows are. Two sparrows sold for a penny. And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Some of you are like, well, I didn't have to count very high. Yeah. Every one of them is numbered, even if you got one. Amen. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. God cares about you a whole lot more than he does them. Not one of them falls to the ground without him knowing. Amen. And he cares about you more, a load more. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. Think about that for just a second. I want to read that again because that's so powerful. Think about it. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. Man, I want that. Amen. That I want that. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. See, there's hope today in Christ. Stick with it. Don't fear the ones who can kill the body but can't touch the soul. Right? Put your fear in the right place. Amen? Did you notice that he says, fear the one who can destroy the body and soul in hell? But he also said, have no fear. Like, don't fear. How does that work? I'm going to tell you how it works. It's perfect love casts out all fear. Amen? God's not up there with a hammer ready to come down on top of your head. He sent his son to die for you so that you could be with him forever. That's how much he loves you. Amen? So let's pray. And if you need to give your life to Jesus, do it today. Don't wait another minute. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this word and the encouragement that comes along with it. Yes, it is a heavy thing to know that the world hates you, and as a result, they're going to hate us. But Lord, I thank you for letting us, you know, giving us fair expectations, realistic expectations when it comes to the world. Because many of us long so much to be a part of it, but we get rejected. And I'm telling you that when it comes to, you know, who we want to accept or reject us, Lord, we want you to accept us. And you say that you will, and you proved it by your work on the cross. And that cross is for all who believe, for all of us who will just repent of our sin. Lord, you forgive us of our sins because of what you did on the cross. And I thank you for that. And Lord, I know that there are some folks here who they may be terrified today. Lord, I pray that your spirit would impress upon them not to be afraid of authorities and governments and courts and all that other kind of stuff. But Lord, that we would love you, that we would fear you, that we would put it in the right place, that we would love you so much that we fear not doing your will. Lord, I pray for those who are here, that Lord, we would endure until the end, that we would live out this salvation, this gospel that you've given us. Lord, I pray that our doctrine would not be tainted by the world, by Satan, but Lord, that we would just rely on your word and your spirit. Lord, I pray that, you know, there's some of us here that we felt the beginnings, the trimmings of that persecution. Experienced a little bit here and there, whatever. But Lord, if your word's true, we know that it is. And it's going to get worse. And Lord, we pray that in those times that we would turn to no other name but yours. Lord, that we would stand on the solid rock that we built our house on. That we would be a light to those in the midst of the darkness. That we would shine your light for all to see. And Lord, I pray that you would give us the courage that anyone that stands before us, we know, needs you. And I pray that you give us the courage and the words to do the work of harvest in our jobs, in our schools, in our lives, in our social gatherings, and in our clubs, wherever it is that we find ourselves before men. Give us the strength to carry out your command. Help us to make disciples. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand and sing. If you want to come forward, if you want to join the church, become a member of the church, you can do that. Just come up and tell me about it. If you need to get baptized, you know, if you've given your life to Jesus and you've never been baptized, then you probably need to do that. So come and talk to me about that. If you need to give your life to the Lord,
come and do that. I know that there's a lot of people walking out, but we're not done. So you stick around, you pray with us. They got to leave for whatever reason, but stick around, stay engaged. Spend some time with the Lord in this moment. I ask this in Jesus' name.
The rugged cross where he died for me.